The man has now come to his senses. He is conscious. He is recovering from the surgery, right? And yes, so when he woke up, in fact, Hannah felt so sorry. She wanted, apologize to him that he was here in this condition. Opened to the pages here, page 36, I think so. Yes. So when she came in the first time, she saw him summon his small strength to be prepared for some fearful thing. So he is come to his senses. He's surprised to see that he is among the Japanese people. So already he's had a bad experience, right? He's escaped and again he's into another problem. Okay, so he's very worried. He's very scared. Don't be afraid, she begged him softly. How come you speak English, he asked. So he's very surprised that how come that she is speaking English. And I don't see any books over here on the table. Hitesh, where is your book? How come you speak English? Yes, how did Hannah know English? Because she had lived in America. She had studied over there. Even Dr. Sitao had also lived in America. Okay. She saw that he wanted to reply to that, but he could not. And so she knelt and fed him gently from the porcelain soup spoon. Sorry, he ate unwillingly, but still he ate. So she fed the man. He was not willing to eat because he felt very helpless. You know, like here I am in the house of the enemy. I don't know what they're going to do to me. How they're going to, treat me. Now you will soon be strong, she said, not liking him and yet moved to comfort him. See, everything here we notice, there's a big contrast in what they are doing and what they are thinking. So one thought is as a good human being. The other is as a patriot, right? So as a patriot, the first thought is always for the benefit of the country. But as good human beings, they don't want that person to die also. So they are there in that very doubtful situation. He did not answer. When Sadao came third day after the operation, he found the young man sitting up, his face bloodless with the effort. So the man is still weak. When he sits, it takes a lot of effort. Okay? Bloodless. Lie down, Sadao cried. You want to die? He forced the man down gently and strongly and examined the wound. You may kill yourself if you do this sort of thing, he scolded. What are you going to do with me? The boy muttered. He looked just now barely 17. Are you going to hand me over? See, even though the man is recovering, but still there is that fear in his mind that what is going to happen to him? What is his fate, right? And yes, so he says that, what are you going to do to me? Once I'm better, once I'm able to walk again, are you going to hand me over to the police? He does not want that to happen. He's scared. And now that the man is there, recovered and washed and cleaned, so he looks not more than, a teenager, right? So he's quite young. For a moment, Sadao did not answer. He finished his examination there and pulled the silk quilt over the man. I do not know myself what I shall do with you, he said. I ought, of course, to give you to the police. You are a prisoner of war. No, do not tell me anything. He put up his hand as he saw the young man was about to speak. Do not even tell me your name unless I ask it. So Sadao wants to maintain distance there. Does not know one, like nothing personal, not even his name. And he says that if you are, the enemy and I should hand you over, right? But then here, of course, he is still not doing that. And he does not want to know anything about the man. They looked at each other for a moment and then the young man closed his eyes and turned his face to the wall. It shows his helplessness. Does not know what to do. Okay, he whispered, his mouth a bitter line. Outside the door, Hannah was waiting for Sadao. He saw at once that she was in trouble. So Hannah wanted to tell Sadao something. Sadao, Yumi tells me the servants feel they cannot stay if we hide this man here anymore. So what have the servants decided to do? To leave. Why? Because who is there in the house? A white man. And it is dangerous, right? So they want to leave. She tells me that they are saying you and I were so long in America, that we have forgotten to think of our own country first. They think we like Americans. Who is going to explain this to the servants? Right? So they think Saddam and Hana both had been in America. And what has happened to them? They like the Americans, right? And they don't know what they have to do at this moment. They can't decide between right and wrong. Varun, wake up. Harsaman is always ready to sleep. Any time of the day. It is not true, Saddam said harshly. Americans are our enemies. I have been trained not to let a man die if I can help it. Now here, this line explains Saddam's behavior. He says, I'm a doctor. And what is my primary duty? To save lives, right? So I can't let a man die. And right now, if that man happens to be an American, it is not his fault. But the servants saying that they are doing wrong. They're putting everyone's life in danger, okay? The servants cannot understand that, she said anxiously. Who? Hana. No, he agreed. Neither seemed able to say more, and somehow the household dragged on. So both of them, they did not continue on this conversation. And somehow the house kept on moving. The work was going on. The servants were there. The servants grew more watchful. Their curtsy was as careful as ever, but their eyes were cold upon the pair to whom they were hired. And they really loved Saddam. They had been working with him since he was a child, especially, you know, like the gardener and all. But right now they are very alert and they don't trust what these people are doing. It is clear what our master ought to do, the old gardener said one morning. He had worked with flowers all his life and had been a specialist too in moss. So we know what moss looks like. Yes, so the green soft, you have your moss sticks also, you have moss, you know, the grass also, right? It is clear what our master ought to do. I've read this, okay? For Saddam's father, he had made one of the finest moss gardens in Japan. So he's such an old person there, very old servant in their home, and he had worked with Saddam's father also, and he's very good at his work. He had made one of the finest moss gardens in Japan, sweeping the bright green carpet constantly so that not a leaf or a pine needle marred the velvet of its surface. So moss then, when it is, you know, spread out across a large distance, it gives a very velvety touch and velvety appearance. And the gardener would keep it very clean, not a single leaf, not a single pine needle. And he had made it very, you know, like with a lot of hard work for Saddam's father. My old master's son knows very well what he ought to do. He knows what he should do. He now said, pinching a bud from a bush as he spoke, when the man was so near death, why did he not let him bleed? What was the condition of the man when they found him? He was bleeding. He was unconscious. And now they're saying when the man was already dead, why did they bring him? They should have let him bleed to death, right? It would have been quite normal. That young master is so proud of his skill to save life that he saves any life. That master likes to save lives and he'll save any life, whether it is an American or a Britisher or a Japanese, anyone, you know, like he'll save anybody's life. Right? Do you think the servants appreciate this quality of Saddam? No, they don't appreciate this quality because they feel it is not something good, right? And especially in the present situation. She split a fowl's neck skillfully and held the fluttering bird and let its blood flow into the roots of a wisteria vine, right? Vine, sorry. So yes, so what was the cook doing at that time? She was there, you know, splitting a fowl's neck, so maybe cutting a bird for the dinner. And what was she doing to the blood? She was putting on in the plants. Blood is the best of fertilizer and the old gardener would not let her waste a drop of it. So this is something new. Maybe you have learned that blood is a fertilizer. It is the children of whom we must think, Yumi said sadly. What will be their fate if their father is condemned as a traitor? So if she's like, Saddam is not worried about his family. Saddam is not worried about his children. What will their future be like if their father has to go to prison, right? what will he be called? A traitor. And imagine the young children growing up and with, you know, like the tag that their father was a traitor. So he's not worried about the future. They did not try to hide what they said from the ears of Hannah as she stood arranging the day's flowers in the veranda nearby. And she knew they spoke on purpose that she might hear. What were the servants doing on purpose? Talking loudly. Why were they talking loudly? So that Hannah could hear their conversation. And Hannah could realize the mistake. So thou was not listening. Maybe Hannah would be able to convince. Okay? That they were right, she knew too in most of her being. But there was another part of her which she herself could not understand. She's very surprised. She knows that, yes, the servants are absolutely right. But she is also right that what they are doing is also right. You can't let a man die, and especially if you're a doctor. It was not sentimental liking of the prisoner. She had come to think of him as a prisoner. She had not liked him even yesterday when he had said in his impulsive way, anyway, let me tell you that my name is Tom. So even though Hannah did not want the information, the young boy could not control himself and he told Hannah his name. What was his name? Tom. Yes. She had only bowed a little distant bow. She saw hurt in his eyes, but she did not wish to assuage it. Indeed, he was a great trouble in this house. So she saw that pain in his eyes, but she did not want to comfort him. She did not want to give him any kind of reassurance because already he has created a lot of problems in the house. So she wanted to let him be like that. As for Sadao, every day he examined the wound carefully. The last stitches had been pulled out this morning and the young man would in a fortnight be nearly as well as ever. Sadao went back to his office and carefully typed a letter to the chief of police reporting the whole matter. On the 21st day of February, an escaped prisoner was washed up on the shore in front of my house. So far he typed and then he opened a secret drawer of his desk and put the unfinished report into it. So Sadao wants to be very particular about it, what he has done. What did he start doing? He started writing a report to the chief of police about his actions. Okay. So when did the prisoner come there in front of his house? On the 21st of Feb. And he's writing that to the chief of police. Was he able to complete it? No, it's incomplete. But then he's kept it in a secret drawer. Why did he keep it in a secret drawer? So that Hannah would not see it. Right, or anybody else who was there coming to their room would not see it, okay? On the seventh day after that, now please remember there is a certain timeline here that we'll be doing. Why is it the seventh day after that? The seventh day after what? Yes. Two things happened. In the morning, the servants left together their belongings tied in large square cotton kerchiefs. So the servants had given them enough warning, had told them time and again that we're not happy with what you're doing. Now, finally, what have they decided? To leave, right? So that day, first thing that happened was the servants left. How did they take the belongings? Right, so just haphazardly, whatever they could find, and then just tied it up in that cloth, and they had left. Okay, when Hannah got up in the morning, nothing was done. The house was not cleaned, and the food not prepared. And she knew what it meant, that the servants are not going to stay there, and the servants are not going to work there any longer. Right. She was dismayed and even terrified, but her pride as a mistress would not allow her to show it. So she was a very proud lady, very self-respecting. She did not want the servants, you know, like, of course, to know that, yes, when they're leaving, it's going to be a big problem for her. How is she going to take care of the house and with the small children around and the prisoner also there? How is she going to manage? But never did she say even a single time that you should not leave. So they decided to leave. She has let them go. Okay. Right. Instead, she inclined her head gracefully when they appeared before her in the kitchen. She paid them off and thanked for all that they had done for her. Never ever did she say, don't go. So she gave them the salary and told them to, yes, if you're leaving, good. They were crying, but she did not cry. She's a strong lady, right? Although, yes, she's been there with these servants throughout her stay over here. The cook and the gardener had served Sadao since he was a little boy in his father's house. And Yumi cried because of the children. The servants were crying because they had been working here so long. Yumi was attached to the children, right? She was so grieving that after she had gone, she ran back to Hana. So she was so sad. They left and again Yumi came back to Hana, right? Why? If the baby misses me too much tonight, send for me. I'm going to my own house and you know where it is. So again, she has come. She said, if something happens, you know, you're not able to take care of the children, I'm going to my house. You know where it is. You can call me. I'll be back. Okay. So this is the love and affection that the servants they had for Sadao and Hana. Thank you, Hana said, smiling, but she told herself she would not send for Yumi, however the baby cried. So we know Hana is proud. She is self-respecting. Okay, right. Sadao saved the prisoner's life because he's a doctor. Why didn't Hana raise her voice? Why didn't Hana stop him? Yes? Why didn't Hana stop him? She could have. There's going to be a big problem in her house, right? Her husband might get arrested. The servants might go and complain. So why didn't she stop her husband? Because it was not her duty. वो भी गई थी तो ये अमेरिका जाने के कारण सदाओ वाज डूइंग दिस सो लेट मी रीपे आई वेंट टू अमेरिका इज इट हाना इज नॉट अ डॉक्टर व्हाई इज हाना सपोर्टिंग हिम यस एज अ ह्यूमन बीइंग एज अ काइंड ह्यूमन बीइंग यस भवनीत Just like that, okay, we've never even bothered. Why is she putting her life into... The servants have left. That means, okay, after the woman is married, she should stop using her brains? Fair? What does he mean to say that? So, of course, here it is not that, but she knew that what her husband was doing was right. After all this discussion, you're saying wrong, right? So, he was doing right, saving the life of a wounded person. There's nothing wrong in it. And if he was ready to put his life at risk, so she is also ready to support him. That's why. It's not because of all the kasme vade and everything, okay? Fine. Yes. Thank you. Hana said smiling, but she told herself she would not send for Yumi. However, the baby cried. Mm-hmm.